So with the year coming to a close, I've decided to look back at animes that I have seen and just pick my favorite ones, the ones that stood out to me the most. And instead of just making a top 10 list, I decided to put these in categories. So hopefully you guys enjoy the choices that I have made. So the award for most obvious anime goes to My Hero Academia. Now this one is probably on everyone's list, so I'll keep it short, and that's why I made it as my first one. You know what's not to like on this show? There's epic fight scenes, you know, as emotional as hell moments, funny characters. This show was definitely my favorite show of the year, and I really don't have anything much to add other than that. I just wanted to keep this one short and just be it there. I got that one out of the way. Now let's go on to the other anime on. So my pick for the best, most generic anime of the season goes to Masamune-kun's Revenge. Now, in generic in terms of characters, all being things that we have seen, four tsundere's, the random girl that just shows up and loves the main character type of thing we've seen. You know, it's set up in a high school which we've seen it a million times. But at least it brings something new to the show, and that being the main character is an actual asshole, and he is liked by most of the females, not just the main cast, but he's super attractive and stuff, and that's just something we don't really have as the main lead character in anime. I thought it was pretty interesting seeing the main character put up a fake appearance at school, and the idea of getting a girl to like you just so you can break her heart is obviously something really dickish to do, and this makes the main lead unlikable, but at the same time, the female lead is not somebody that you would feel pity for if it happened to them. So by the end of these show, you just really want these two people to get together, and I enjoyed it because of that. I just wanted to see what happened to these characters. So in terms of my favorite plot slash setting, this goes to Saga of Tanya of Evil, or let me try butchering the name, Yojo Senki. I can't say it. I like war anime, and I like main characters that actually have some backbone to them. I will also just note I will be referring to the main character as her because it is a guy trapped in a girl's body, but just to make it easier for me, it's a her. So Yujo Senki was the perfect combination of the two, a war and a strong main character. You know, it was nice to see a character that wasn't terrified of everything that was happening around him and could actually stand up and do what was needed to be done, and not just because of the power of friendship or love or stuff like that. It was simply because they had a hatred for God or being X, and they wanted to do whatever they could just to make it so they could have an easy life. It feels relatable. A lot of time in anime, I feel like the power of friendship thing isn't very relatable to me, but the idea of doing whatever you can just to make your life easier, it definitely feels pretty relatable. I also kind of like that even though Tanya was all powerful, there were still limits to what she could do simply because she was in the military, so she still had to abide by rank, and I kind of like that limiting factor of it. Now, there was a little bit of, in terms of the war, there were some planning stages and things like that, but nothing too crazy or in depth. And I don't know, I appreciated it. It was nice to see that. And as the main character, we have Tanya. We also have another main character, which I can't remember her name at this moment. And the side character kind of balanced out what I felt was Tanya's pure evilness and this girl's pure cuteness and being a good character. So it was a nice balance between those two, and I like that too. So, oh man, this show was the weirdest thing I saw. Let me start with the most simple part of the show, and that is the plot. Basically, there's a kiss note, and any two people's names that are written on it will kiss and fall in love. Now, throw that plot out the window like three episodes in, and now we've got this show, Love Tyrant. I was originally going to drop this show after an episode one because I just could not adjust to how fast paced the things were going and just how nonsensical the whole show was. I couldn't even figure out what type of world this was in because people were just getting stabbed like nothing. There are angels, there's magic, there's assassins, there's just so much happening in this show. And looking just at our main character's design, he has blue hair. When's the last time you saw a main male character in a school setting that has a hair color other than black or dark brown? Fortunately, this isn't just a school setting. We also see our characters go to hell, we also see them go to heaven. So there's variety in this show. There's more than enough variety in this show. You know, at the start, it was overwhelming for me because I do like structured shows, things that are explained, stuff like that. But by the third episode, I realized I just did not care about that. And I was just laying back, laughing, and just enjoying myself with the ridiculousness of what was happening in this show. The way the comedy was done was through these little overreaction shots, which I enjoyed a lot in this show. And God, the running gag of the cat in the main character was easily the funniest thing that happens. And I will probably remember that those jokes for the rest of my anime watching life. Even thinking about them right now, I am laughing. Love Tyrant, not the best show. It still has some faults in it, but it is funny as hell. And I will definitely be reading the manga or anything that I can get my hands on to continue watching this show. So my favorite continuation of a series has to be the show Siren or Saren. I don't know how to pronounce it. But it's not because it's the best show or the best written thing. But it's simply, I like the series Amagami SS. I've liked Photokanon, although I felt that was the weakest one of them all. And here we got Saren. So this was the only relationship-focused show that I watched this year, and I was pretty happy with it. The biggest problem that people have with these shows is that basically the main character goes out with one girl, and at the end of her arc, time basically just resets, and the main character goes out with another girl, and any time spent with her, a lot of people feel like it was just for nothing. But I enjoy the time spent with the girls more than the promise of a long relationship that happens in anime that most people expect. So for me, it's more about the journey, I guess, instead of the ending. And that's why I'm able to enjoy these shows. I don't really care about the reset. I just enjoy seeing what shenanigans or stuff can happen when they're together. And then I'm fine seeing what happens with the other girl. I personally like the girls featured in this show, so that also kind of helps my enjoyment of the show, especially the one that played video games. I don't know if anybody's really seen the show, but I can see why people critique these and don't like it, but I personally am a fan of the show and series as a whole. So the Kakarot starts off really strong with an interesting premise of contact with an alien and adult main character, and hooray, we did not send 14-year-olds to deal with an alien that could kill off all humanity. I know, impressive, we're making progress, guys. Instead, this show is more about humanity reacting to an alien. It giving us technology to further improve our lives. You know, there are some similarities to Arrival, if you've seen that movie, in the first half of the show, but they're not the exact same thing. There are some big differences that can only be really done in anime. Now, major spoilers, but unfortunately, it's not really that surprising that they did this, but the alien actually ends up being bad and wants to take over humanity. Now we throw out the conversations about what it means to be human, what it means to work together, and you know what it's like to meet a god, and instead we're going to make an action anime for like the last three episodes. It's just so out of nowhere and just so disappointing because of this, because first we had talks. It was just a talking anime, basically. And all of a sudden now it's an action anime. It's just so crazy. It made no sense to me. I will say that the start of episode 10, like the first 6 minutes, has like no dialogue, just text and music, and this is easily the best scene in the anime, and probably in my top two for the whole year. It is just so peaceful. It gives you a great amount of backstory in one of the characters, and it's simply just beautiful to watch. I love that thing. Now this show does get some critique for its use of CGI instead of just regular 2D hand-drawn animation. I personally have no problem with this, and it was fine when it happened in Ajin to me, but it definitely is jarring when you first see it. In episode 0, they used 2D art, and switch to CGI next episode. It definitely was a downgrade, and the hand drawing that does happen throughout the show is really, really good. So to see the downgrade to CGI, it kind of sucks, but it's not something that killed the show for me. So let's go with most enjoyable. Now, a little secret about me, I have a thing for crazy characters, crazy female characters, but it has to be just right. You know, Beatrice had it in the When They Cry show, Junko had it in Danganronpa, and this year, Jabami Yumeko has it in Kakegurui. This was an enjoyable show to watch because, damn, she looks great. And Jabami has a perfect mix of quiet, naive, and reserved character with straight-out crazy in some scenes. And I love to see those things in one character. Plus, I really like it when they draw their hair in mass detail. It really looks amazing. Aside from my attraction to Yumeko, I also liked watching the games they played. I was quite happy that she not win all the time. But the only problem I had it was that any mystery that had to be solved, such as how the opponent was cheating, could not be solved by the viewer just by watching this show. It could only be solved by the characters and in total anime ways that couldn't be done in like real life. And I wish I could have solved some of them too, but unfortunately we could not. Even with that, I enjoyed watching the games and just seeing how weird, crazy the characters could be, and you know what kind of games they could come up with. You know, the show had its problems here and there, but I enjoyed it in the end, and I just wish Netflix did not make us wait like 6 months for it so I could have seen it immediately when it came out, but nope. For the last show, it really saddens me to say this, but Hellgirl Season 4 was easily the most disappointing anime that I have seen in a long, long time. I normally try not to get too hyped for a show, but all three seasons of Hellgirl are high up on my list, getting 9s and 8s, so when I saw that there was going to be a new season after almost like 10 years, I was excited. you know, Enma Ai's voice is just simply amazing, and I was happy to hear it again, but sadly, that's mostly the only good thing in this show. In the art department, the show is super low detailed and very basic, and honestly felt like I was watching a 2006 anime. When it came to the episodes, the first one was pretty standard, which was totally fine because it had been so long since we've watched the show, so I was fine with a generic first episode, or pretty normal episode for Hellgirl. The second episode was a good tale about friendship, but nothing too crazy, and the third episode was also about a terrible family, a character dealing with the struggle of sending somebody to hell, but also about their own fate being made to go to hell at the end of their life. So that was interesting to see, but the last minute of that episode was really, I don't know, kind of weird. I didn't like it. The fourth episode was really good and by far the best episode of the season, and it allows One Yudo to be the main character, which was nice. I always like seeing the side characters in this show just being thrust up and being the main characters, because they're all interesting and I just want to know more about them. Now, episode 5 and episode 6 are where everything falls down. The revenge stories are okay, but that's not really the main part of the episodes. It's really about Enma Ai getting replaced by another character as Hellgirl. Now, in the past season, this struggle, the person not wanting to become Hellgirl, could take over 10 or 13 episodes. Sometimes it's half the series. But in this one, it takes only one episode. Everything from the last season is just simply thrown away, and there is no satisfying conclusion, no nothing. It just feels like it ends out of nowhere, and I thought I had 12 episodes to watch, but nope, there's only 6 episodes in this season. The last 6 episodes are just simply reruns of previous episodes from past seasons. I have no clue why they did that. I don't know if it was budget reasons. I don't even know why you would just rerun episodes from previous seasons on your 4th season. I don't know. Now, my last thing is just shows that I want to watch. Currently, I'm watching Recreators, which is a little bit more about characters from fantasy worlds coming to our world, being transported into a world. It's currently pretty interesting. I like it. I'm on episode 3, so I'm having fun watching that. I also kind of want to watch the Ancient Magus Bride. It's not done yet, so that's why it's not on this series, on this top 10. Not even top 10. But it's not here because it's not done. I just don't like watching anime when they aren't done. I don't like following episodes week by week. I just like finishing the whole thing when I can. I also have Junie Tyson. I know it has a low score on my anime list, but I'm still interested by the Battle Royale type things. So I will be definitely watching that even if it's not good. It's the type of show I like. And I will be watching Made in Abyss simply because I've heard a lot of good things about it. You know, the art style is not my thing, but I'll try it and see if I end up liking it. Anyway, that's the end for this top 10. It's just a list of my anime that stood out to me this year. Some of them were good. Some of them were Hellgirl. And that's the end of it. So hopefully you guys found this interesting. And I'll see you guys in the next video or next year in my next leak video. Bye.